Buenas tardes a todos. Gracias por estar aquí. Michael Horn es un investigador de la Universidad de Northwestern, que está en Chicago, en los Estados Unidos. Es profesor titular de una forma interesante porque es parte de un acuerdo en combinación entre el Departamento de Computer Science y el Departamento de Learning Science. Por lo tanto, está a caballo de las dos. Su investigación se basa en interacción y aprendizaje, básicamente, con muchos aspectos de interacción tangible, pero abarca más tipos de interacción. Evidentemente, centrado en aprendizaje, pero sobre todo en aprendizaje no formal, como por ejemplo en el caso de museos, y es lo que hoy nos va a hablar. Afortunadamente, también está muy centrado en aspectos culturales de la interacción, en cómo todos estos aspectos influencian a los usuarios, influencian a los sistemas y a la relación entre los dos. Algo muy importante que a menudo se descuida mucho y por lo tanto a mí me pareció increíblemente importante, sobre todo en el contexto en el que nos encontramos del máster. Yo le conozco desde hace ya bastantes años a través del Congreso Interaction Design and Children, donde por suerte nos conocimos y hemos podido compartir diversas charlas y debates y discusiones y compartir los trabajos de otra gente en estas conferencias que se hacen cada año y las cuales son muy, muy interesantes. Y él además es editor-in-chief, es decir, editor-jefe, junto con otro investigador, del Journal on Child Computer Interaction. Y eso también es importante porque es un sitio donde se pueden ver muchísimas referencias, muchísimos textos relacionados con interacción, con aprendizaje y con todos los aspectos de desarrollo de los niños. Y es una excelente noticia de que él aceptase hace creo que poco más de un año pasar a ser editor in chief después del excelente trabajo que habían hecho los anteriores para promover este journal. Y estoy muy contento de poder presentarlo aquí y de poder compartir su charla. Así que, thank you, Mike, for being here, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Narcis, and thank you so much for inviting me and having me present with you. Please, as I talk, I hope that you can ask questions or thoughts and reactions in the chat, and I'm more than willing to engage with people as the presentation goes. Okay, I'm going to share my screen. Okay, so as Narcis said, my name is Mike. I am a researcher at Northwestern University, and I'm in the field of computer science and learning sciences. And so I'm interested in questions of how do we use emerging forms of interactive technology to create new opportunities for learning. And I'm particularly interested in informal spaces of learning, as Narcis was saying. Just very briefly, if you've never been to Northwestern University, we are just north of the city of Chicago on Lake Michigan. I direct our PhD program in learning sciences. I also am co-director of our joint PhD program in computer science and learning sciences. So if anyone is interested in someday pursuing a PhD and you are perhaps interested in Northwestern, you should feel free to reach out to me. And I'm more than happy to talk about our programs. Okay, so the question I'd like to think about with you today is how do we create meaningful and effective experiences for out-of-school learning spaces? Okay, this is kind of like learning without a net. You don't have teachers, you don't have curriculum, people engage with your designs any way they want to, and we hope that they take away a meaningful experience. We hope that they learn something. And the question I'm interested in is how do we designed for these kinds of spaces. And so I'll share a few, like some of my work. I'll try to go, you know, relatively quickly through it, but please ask questions if you have them. So I'd like to start with a project that I was involved in around 10 years ago. It was the project called Life on Earth. And around that time, people were very interested in large interactive displays, sort of like that you can see here, as a form that might work well in public spaces like museums. Okay, so what we were interested in this project was designing museum exhibits for natural history museums. And we were particularly interested in this. And hopefully all of you recognize this. This is an evolutionary tree or a phylogenetic tree. And it shows the history and relationships of a group of organisms. So for example, this one shows that the Tyrannosaurus rex and modern birds shared a common ancestor. Okay, and then bats and giraffes also shared a common ancestor. And you can see that then those two clades, those two groups, then shared a more distant common ancestor. Okay, so it shows how life on Earth is related over time and how different branches of the tree of life evolved. Okay, so there's a couple of problems with this representation. Hopefully you've all seen this whenever you go to a museum. The problems being that many visitors have a hard time understanding what these representations mean. They don't really get what they mean, and if anything, they take away, oh, look, birds and bats are, they're next to each other, so they must be closely related. And they both have wings, you know, so it seems obvious. The other problem, there's several problems, but one other problem is that this does in no way convey the immensity and complexity of life on Earth and the just enormous story that, you know, billions of years story of evolution. So we were setting out in this project to see, could we design exhibits that made this representation more meaningful to people, that was a way to start learning around evolution and natural history. So a couple of things that we did. This was an exhibit that I created for this project called Build a Tree. And you have to remember, this was around the time that the iPad was first kind of emerging and people had these tablet computers that they could touch. And it was also sort of the height of the early stages of like casual video games. So Angry Birds, if you remember, Angry Birds was a very, very popular video game at the time. And so we were interested, could we use this informal game genre as a way to get visitors at a natural history museum to want, you know, desire to engage with this tree of life, which would otherwise be, there's no way that a visitor would want to. And so I'll show you a brief video of some visitors using this exhibit, and then hopefully you'll be able to hear this. Let's see.
Yes, you have this one over here. Exactly. Perfect. Yes, maybe I'm there. I'm trying everything on the TV here. One second.
Okay, so hopefully you saw this was a family of three people. They were collaboratively trying to solve this puzzle of how organisms are related. Before this segment started, they had spent about, 4 or 5 minutes on this level trying to figure it out, and they were stuck. And they sort of accidentally connected arthropods to insects, and they saw that, that became a valid clade. And so then they were sort of had this breakthrough moment, which was like, I have three sub trees. How do I connect those three sub trees? And this was like a kind of a breakthrough learning point for them that then scaffolded their exploration with later levels, like this one here when they moved on to level 7. So what we found with this, we published a study at CHI a number of years ago, which is the ACM Human Computer Interaction Conference, that showed that, you know, visitors spent, you know, a reasonable amount of time, like 3 or 4 minutes on their own, voluntarily exploring these things, sometimes much longer because they were interested in, they were motivated by solving the puzzle. They were actively engaging with this representation of the tree of life. We explored other design ideas. This was a project called Deep Tree. And the idea here was, rather than having a small number of organisms, what if we had something like 70,000 organisms, which is still a small fraction of the story of life on Earth, but I think it tells a much more interesting story of life on Earth. So just very briefly, this is what this looked like. You start at the origins of life, and then you can search for an animal, like, say, koala bears. So we're going to find the koala bears in the tree of life. And it was called Deep Tree because of this deep zoom interaction technique that you would zoom and zoom and zoom until you arrive at modern day koala bears. Okay. And again, our point here was, let's start to complexify this picture and story of evolution. And we, you know, we did a study. We found that, you know, people learned with this exhibit. We compared it to watching a video about evolution and saw that people were more engaged. They talked more, they argued more, they took away more learning outcomes from this kind of experience. Okay, so the reason I wanted to start with these is that we saw some engagement, like visitors could use these things, but there was also something that felt hollow or superficial about the experiences that visitors were having. It didn't feel like they were really deeply engaging on a meaningful level. And some of you might be familiar with Brett Victor. He's an interaction designer and a writer and a researcher. And around the time that we were doing these exhibits, he published this brief rant on the future of interaction design. And he calls this paradigm of interacting with screens pictures under glass. He says, now take out your favorite magical and revolutionary technology device and use it for a bit. What did you feel? Did it feel glassy? Did it have no connection whatsoever with the task you were performing? I call this technology pictures under glass. Pictures under glass sacrifice all the tactile richness of working with our hands, instead offering a hokey visual facade. And he goes on to write, pictures under glass is an interaction paradigm of permanent numbness. It's a Novocaine drip to the wrist. It denies our hands what they do best, and yet it's the star player in every vision of the future. And, you know, I couldn't help but feel that he's right here, that these screen-based experiences that we were creating felt superficial. They felt like pictures under glass. And I want to contrast that with some other experiences that we created. This was a research project that my PhD student Zena Leong did for her dissertation. And what she did, this was, she said, what if we took everything we knew about how to design really good science museum exhibits and we applied them in a different context? And in particular, she was interested in pediatric hematology clinic waiting rooms. So pediatric hematology is clinics for children with blood disorders. So you can think of things like leukemia or sickle cell disease. And so kids would come into these clinics on a regular basis for treatments and, you know, blood transfusions or whatever. And so what she did is she created an exhibit. She wrapped a tree in her backyard in fiberglass and created this enormous blood vessel. And then she sewed bean bags that were representing different types of blood cells. So red blood cells, white blood cells, platelets, sickle cells, and so on. And then she set this up in the clinic waiting room for kids to play with while they were waiting to see the doctor. And kids just love this thing. Like, they would spend their entire time that they had to wait for the doctor just experimenting with, they would feel the blood vessels, the different types of blood vessels, the sickle cells feel tacky and hard, the red blood cells feel soft, the white blood cells feel different, the platelets feel tacky and hard as well. They would show each other how to use it. They would take turns. They would experiment with all sorts of different arrangements. They would slide all the sickle cells down the slide at the same time, and you could see them getting bunched up at the intersection points here. But this experience was so, so different than what we were seeing in the other designs that I showed you with the tabletops, that there was something that felt deeply motivating and interesting and engaging for kids that they spent so long interacting. Another quick example, this was an exhibit, just a very temporary exhibit that we showed in Chicago at the Museum of Science and Industry. It was a beat machine. So these colored balls are different types of drum sounds. So the blue balls, the dark blue balls are kick drums, and the orange balls are hi-hats, and the light blue balls are snare drums. And basically we had some beat patterns that you could follow, but we let just families play with arranging balls on this table. And hopefully you can, the sound is not great, but hopefully you can hear the beat going on in the background. And again, it was this thing, it was an incredibly simple design. We were shocked by how much people really just loved playing with this. They would stay for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes. We had one group stay for 40 minutes. They would come play with the exhibit. They would go off and do some other things, and then they would come back and use the exhibit again. And it was just, it was really, I don't know how to put it, like, kind of shocking to us how, you know, we thought people might enjoy it, but we weren't prepared for how much they seem to enjoy interacting with this. We published a paper about this at IDC in 2020, and we compared this version of it to a multi-touch tabletop exhibit that did the same thing. And we found, you know, both exhibits were engaging, but this one was better at engaging young children. It was better engaging whole families. People stayed longer. They engaged in behaviors like singing, dancing, photographing one another. The dad here, the father in this family is right here in the back, and he's about to start. He just sort of busts out in a freestyle rap about the family's trip to the museum, and he raps just sort of like freestyle for, you know, a few minutes, just telling the story of their family's trip to the museum. Here, let's see if I can fast forward to that part. So he's about to start his wrap here. And then when he starts that, the whole family starts to dance and they like kind of go along with the dad. Okay. So again, my question is, what is it about these physical embodied experiences? And I've been doing this for a long time, that again and again and again seems to provide a much richer, more meaningful, more engaging, more socially compelling experience for families. Okay, and I think there's lots of reasons that we could think about. Brett Victor, with his pictures under glass, has some important clues. One idea I'd like to talk about today is what I call cultural forms of literacy, learning, and play, as Narcisse mentioned in the introduction. And my hypothesis here is that physical embodied things, objects, artifacts, interactive experiences are more effective at communicating and evoking powerful cultural forms. And that then as designers, as we're thinking about creating experiences, we can build on that foundation as a way to make these experiences more meaningful for people. Just very briefly, I'm adopting this term from the work of Jeff Sachs, who's a learning scientist, who talks about cultural forms as historically elaborated social constructions, conventions, and systems of representations. And I'm also using Mike Cole's, has an idea of artifact as an aspect of the material world that has been modified over the history of its incorporation into goal-directed human activity. So both of these people are kind of thinking about the role of artifact and cultural forms as part of a broader phenomena that is these kind of culturally embedded activity systems. Okay. And you know, we can think about all sorts of cultural forms. Like this is a good one. Like if I cover my eyes and start to count 1, 2, 3, 4, you might feel like the need to hide under your desk or turn off your camera because we're going to play a game, you know, called hide and seek. And there are many, many examples of these kinds of cultural forms. But so my premise is that designers can intentionally shape objects and situations to evoke cultural forms, that those forms in turn invite participation into patterned social activity. Those activities involve situated resources on the part of individuals, like playing hide and seek. We're bringing this rich repertoire of knowledge and skills into that activity. And almost any human activity that we recognize, we have a very well practiced set of things that we can do. Forms are malleable, they can be combined and remixed to support novel experiences. And then lastly, forms can suggest a relationship between the learning domain, our individual identities as learners, and existing cultural expectations. So that's where I'm starting from. Let me just give a few examples I think that will maybe help explain what I mean by this. So this is a wonderful example called the SMS slingshot, done by a group of researchers. It was first, I think, published in a number of places, but you can find it in TEI 13. Ava Hornecker was one of the people involved. But this, what it is it's a way of shooting digital graffiti onto the side of buildings. So if you're like, I'm enraged at, you know, the local government, I'm gonna type my message into the slingshot, and I'm going to throw virtual graffiti against the side of the building. And they saw this as a way for people to reclaim urban spaces that had been taken away by authoritative and oppressive forms of government. And you notice the purpose of the object, which is like to take back, for people to take back urban spaces, matches the sort of biblical form of the slingshot. Like, we know what a slingshot is. We know that its purpose is to hurl objects. It is combined with this text message keypad that we know is used to send messages, or at least when this was published, that was the way it worked. And it has these deep cultural biblical implications of the sort of David and Goliath story. The small individual fighting up against the large, you know, oppressive invader entity. Okay, so this is an example of mixing various cultural forms to create something new that people and sort of inherently and intuitively know how to engage with. Wonderful examples from your own university, the work of Narcisse in particular, mixing cultural forms like children's slides with video game elements, or these are designed here for children with autism, using the net. So it's hard to see here, but the children have butterfly nets. And we understand that a butterfly net is for capturing insects and scooping. And so using that form as a way to scaffold the interaction with this world that they created digitally. Or this refugee project here that invites augmented reality interaction with cultural heritage sites and spaces. So these are all wonderful examples where we see a remixing of cultural forms of literacy, cultural forms of learning, cultural forms of play within these digital interactive systems to create something new and interesting. Some of my other work, this is some of my work early on. This was my dissertation work where I created physical programming languages for young children. So this was kindergarten age children. And this was a long time ago, but we were interested in using, you know, things like wooden blocks, children's toys, as a way to build physical algorithmic structures, programs. We created a museum exhibit at the Boston Museum of Science where you could program this robot here on the stage using physical wooden blocks. And what we did is we compared the use of wooden blocks to the use of a mouse and a computer display. So you would use a mouse to sort of drag blocks on the screen. It kind of looked like, let's see here. It kind of looked like this. And so what we did is we just ran a study where we compared how did people interact with these things versus these things. And everything else was the same. The exhibit was the same. It was just the way that you programmed the robot that changed. And we saw some really interesting things. This is a chart that shows how likely visitors were to try the exhibit. So if they saw the exhibit, did they stop and try it? Did they touch it and interact with it? And we saw that the dark bars are for the mouse and the graphical user interface, and the light bars are for the wooden blocks. So we saw that adult men are slightly more likely to use the mouse. But for every other group, visitors were much more likely to use, and significantly more likely to use, the wooden block. So for example, girls, roughly a third of girls tried the mouse-based exhibit, whereas something like 85.7% of girls tried the tangible exhibit. And trying to explain what is going on here, you know, why do we see this? My argument is that things like wooden blocks evoke a very powerful cultural form that says, play with me, build with me, construct with me, explore with me. And that a computer mouse and a graphic display fail to communicate as effectively those ideas, that those cultural forms of play, those cultural forms of engagement. This work, we've been, you know, continuing this work over the years. This was a group of undergrads built this version of this that works with an iPad, a system called the Osmo that's now become a commercial product that you can buy that uses these plastic blocks. okay. So I'm going to shift gears a little bit. I want to stay with this idea of cultural forms of interaction, but I want to talk about a more recent project that my research group has been engaged in called TunePad. And this is a platform that combines music with computer coding, and I'll show you a little bit about what that looks like. So just a few premises. The first premise, and I think this is really important to state for anyone involved in computer science, is that coding, computer science, yes, it is a science, yes, it is an engineering discipline. But I don't think that that's why most of us do it. I think most of us engage in programming and computer science because we somehow fell in love with programming. So I tend to think of programming as more of a humanity, like poetry, literature, art, dance. It's something we do because it provides meaning to the human experience. And it's a sort of provides meaning to our lives. So it's a way of being human that brings us joy and fulfillment. So we're starting kind of from that point. The second premise is that music is a pervasive cultural form of literacy. Okay, and music has abundant connections, and I'll show you this, that music has the abundant connections to computer science, concepts and practices, ideas from computer science. But that we come just by being in our culture, we have this incredibly rich set of foundational literacy experiences for what music is. And then the third part of this here is that computation, I see computation or like computer programming as a kind of literacy in and of itself. Okay. We can talk about this because this framing is actually a little problematic, and I'd be happy to go into this in the Q&A. But there is an issue here that calling something a literacy and saying that, hey, all of you in the audience are literate. You're computationally literate, okay? By doing that, I've just called a whole bunch of other people illiterate. And so by constructing literacy, I also construct illiteracy. And as we know, illiteracy carries a stigma. And we also know that literacy has been used as a tool of empowerment. But just as often, literacy gets used as a tool of oppression. You have to speak my language, and my language counts. Your language does not count. Okay? And I will teach my language in schools and marginalize your language. So we have to be very thoughtful and careful when we start to call something a literacy. But let's just leave this here for now. We're going to say that computation is a kind of literacy. And then the fourth premise is that like really interesting things can happen when you start to bring literacies together, when they collide and we create new ways of engagement. You know, and just, you know, some to situate this Chicago is a wonderful music city. It's the birthplace of so many forms of music, such as house, Chicago variants of hip hop. This is a Chicago dance and music form called footwork. And in footwork, I can just play a little bit. So in footwork, you have crews of dancers face off against one another in these dance battles. And that involves these like really high tempo, highly digitally produced forms of music. And it involves these very intricate and elaborate like dance moves that are mostly lower body down. Like you're not using your upper body, it's mostly all like waist down is where the dance moves come in. Okay. And this is a highly technical domain of artistic creation. Like the people who create music like this are geeked out on tools, you know, like Ableton or Max. Like the technology here is you know, and the expertise is really mind-boggling. So how people can engage. And so what we've been doing, let me just show you what TunePad is and what it looks like. Stop sharing for a second. All right. All right, so this is TunePad. TunePad is a free online platform that lets communities of learners create and share music using Python computer programming. When you're on the site, you can sort of browse through music created by other people, and everything is remixable. So you can listen to something and then say, oh, I want to learn how to make that, and then remix it for yourself. This is a TunePad project. TunePad projects use a computational notebook paradigm. So if you're familiar with something like Jupyter Notebooks, it's a very similar idea. So you have cells. So this is a cell. Cell contain text, images, or videos. And then cells can also contain musical instruments. So hopefully you can hear this. This is a musical instrument that I can play. I can play it with a mouse. I can play it with a keyboard, a touchpad. If I have a MIDI device, like a keyboard, I can plug that in and play using MIDI. But the main way that you play an instrument is by writing short Python scripts. So for example, this might be hard to hear just over Teams audio, but hopefully you can hear that. And then I can layer in different sounds. So for example, here, I'm going to declare some variable names for different drum sounds. And I can layer in my drum track. And it starts to get interesting where, like, here, what I want to do is play a set of chords. I'm creating lists in Python that represent the chords. I'm using loops to play those chords over and over and over again. So that's an example of like what a TunePad project looks like. You can create all sorts of music. Like for example, this is you know, a really simple project that recreates the Stranger Things, you know, theme song or a small part of it. So you can do that kind of thing. This was a recent one of our recent coaches. So we have coaches for after school programs made this remix of a, I don't know if anyone knows this song. This is an Arctic Monkeys song. Mm-hmm. So that's the basic idea with TunePad. We are currently running after-school programs all around the city of Chicago, and other places. And we bring in physical elements. So we've been doing a lot, playing around a lot with the idea of digital drum circles, where what we'll do is we'll do physical drum circles as a means of engagement and thinking about music, also as a means of being in community with one another. To do a drum circle well, you have to be able to listen to your peers who are also contributing to the drum pattern. And then we convert that into digital drum circles where everyone hops into the same TunePad project together. And the way that works is like each person takes a cell in the TunePad project, each person has an instrument that's theirs, and they're coding together in the same space to create music in real time together. So it kind of brings this idea of drum circles into the digital space. And we do, you know, showcase events and where we have young people creating music. This is, and I promise I'm wrapping up here. These are just some of like our coaches. I'm gonna play this one because Narcisse says I can't play reggaeton, so here it goes. This is one of our coaches. Or this was another project that one of our coaches did. In all of this work, what we're doing right now with young people is exploring different modalities of self-expression and creative expression. We're particularly interested right now in TikTok, or this kind of genre of very short music, dance videos that highlight and elevate coding to the level of performance art. And so we're working to create for young people to create showcases of their TikTok videos that sort of show off what they can do with code as a way to kind of bootstrap let's just call it like a coding counterculture that rejects establishment academic school-based computer science and sort of gives coding back to communities as a medium of creative expression. Okay. So that's all I wanted to share with you. Thank you so much again for having me. There are many, many, many people behind this work. This is only a small number of the people that have been involved in these projects. Many of my students or other people, co-investigators and so on. Thank you again for having me, and I'd love to answer questions or engage you in any conversation or ideas.